So you're having a busy week.
Yeah.
Busy's good, I guess, although...
Yeah, it's okay. I'm looking forward to the weekend, though. It's Friday afternoon.
And that's right. You work and people have weekends.
I don't really have a weekend either, because artists don't really have weekends, so...
That's true. You're 24, you're 24/7.
Yeah, even in our dreams.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue.
Virgin Valley Artists Association welcomes you to the Art Box, recorded in our beautiful Mesquite, Nevada, and sponsored by the Virgin Valley Artists Association. Our association has something for everyone of all ages. Come and get creative with us at 15 West Mesquite Boulevard, or find us online at mesquitefineartcenter.com or on Facebook as Mesquite Fine Art Center. Also on Facebook, The Art Box.
But I like to get to know you. Hi, Rachelle. Welcome to The Art Box.
Hi. Thank you so much for having me.
And we're doing this. Linda and I are in Mesquite, Nevada at the Steam Center, our studio. Rachelle is in Oakland.
Yeah, I'm in Oakland, California. Leaves down in Ohlone Land.
Okay, and the reason I know Rachelle and bugged her to get on this is Rachelle was part of the Modern Desert Markings exhibit, the Marjorie Barrick Museum at UNLV in Las Vegas. Rachelle happened to take her life in her hands. I think you rode with me the day out to Jean Lake, right?
I rode with Rayette.
First off, you want to tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. I am a research-based artist, so I make various series of artworks, usually like two or three series at a time, based on a specific environment or a specific material that environment comes from. And I will research that either physically, materially, and by visiting the site, but also through satellite imagery and tracking these different landscapes through satellite Earth images.
Was your art always this way, or were you schooled in the more traditional art?
That's a great question. I was very much traditional. I grew up in New Jersey, and I don't come from a family of artists whatsoever, very practical people. And so when my understanding of what art was to be able to draw and paint really well for the first probably like 20-ish years of my life, I really focused on being able to depict life realistically and create that illusion in paint and in drawing materials. And then I got to a point where I was wondering why I was wanting to, you know, replicate things so lifelike, especially when we have technologies that can do it for us, and what's that function? And so the work started evolving from there.
I looked online and saw a lot of pictures of your salt studio, which you said you worked on that project during the pandemic, and you did quite big pieces, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I've been doing that series for about 10 years. I started in 2013, and the reason why I started working with salt is because of my interest in the San Francisco Bay and trying to understand this landscape where I live materially through salt itself. So I found a really interesting rabbit hole I went down that I'm still going down for next currently. Yeah, so I've worked pretty large. My largest pieces to date have been 8 feet diameter tondos. It was all made with salt from hand harvested from the San Francisco Bay, and just doing a lot of research on the ecosystem down there, the estuary throughout the Bay Area, kind of the unique environment that fosters and how that's been so pivotal to the development of the Bay Area up until this very day. It's still a very interesting spot because it's an area where we are focusing on restoration. A lot of the salt evaporation ponds that had existed for over 200 years, a lot of those areas, like 90% of them, were donated back to California and have been working to be restored in various ways. But it's this space that we have to really consider what, you know, when we think about restoring landscape, thinking about, you know, it's not just reverting back to how things were before we industrialized the space and before humans, you know, touch foot on the landscape. It's more of how do we negotiate with all how nature has adapted, because it has, and still rehabilitate the landscape, but not destroy the ecosystem that developed because of the industry that lived there, if that makes sense. For example, the salt evaporation ponds became a pivotal resting point for migratory birds from the Pacific Flyway, it's like a bird highway basically from Alaska down to South America, because so many other spots these migratory birds had used for resting spaces had been developed. This was a really important place for them. So just thinking through, you know, not only this specific location, but how does this space even play into a larger system, like such as migratory birds that spans thousands of miles.
Who manages that land?
I believe it's owned by the state of California. It's the South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project.
Okay.
I encourage you to look it up. It's super cool.
The South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project, going since 2005, is the largest tidal wetland restoration project on the West Coast. When complete, the project will restore 15,100 acres of industrial salt ponds to a rich mosaic of tidal wetlands and other habitats.
It sounds like you're a scientist, environmentalist, and artist.
I think one of the jobs of being an artist is asking a lot of questions and analyzing the world around you, not only visually, but in all ways. And so it kind of naturally comes into play. I think that art definitely inspires a huge curiosity, and that's definitely what propels my projects more than anything else, I'd say. And life experience, too.
Can you talk about the power of salt?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, salt is significant in almost every culture. It's the only rock we eat, so just think about that for a minute. And I always like to think about our bones are made of minerals, right? And so, essentially, we're all built upon rocks. So thinking about the only rock we ingest is almost like a way in which we take in the earth. And then just culturally, it's known as being able to purify spaces, cleanse evil energies. It's referenced in a lot of important religious manuscripts. We physically need it to survive. It's what helps the synapses in our muscles, that helps us move around. And it's changed the way the world, we've inhabited the world. I mean, if we think about different wars that were fought or maps that were drawn for salt pilgrimages or religious rituals or even animal migrations for salt. It's just so essential. One of the reasons why after 10 years, I'm still working on it with it, because it holds so much.
Yeah, that's interesting. Can you talk about the early inhabitants, and if you want to talk about this, but this I found interesting, maybe educate our listeners on the early inhabitants of the San Francisco Bay Area, obviously before it was called the San Francisco Bay.
Sure. San Francisco Bay Area is home to the Ohlone, or at least where I am, and then some different. Ohlone is an overall kind of name for just different smaller tribes that existed within the San Francisco Peninsula and the East Bay, down in the South Bay. Also, there's record of them harvesting salt. They would basically put twigs or like sticks at the edge of the bay and then just let the natural salt evaporation occur and crystallize these sticks of salt. That's what I read. And then they would take it to their cooking areas, and then that's how they would have their salt and salt their food. They would also use it a lot for trade. There was a lot of trade that existed between the coastal indigenous population and the inland indigenous populations. It was a huge resource for that too. I remember reading that is also, and I read this and I cannot find where I read this, so I can't fact check it, but I thought it was beautiful and it stuck with me, that it was also an exchange for friendship during trade. So it was a way of building community as well.
Rachelle, I love the pictures on your site of the suns and the salt and ash moon and other moons. I found the picture fascinating, that showing four strong men picking up one of your pieces. They're quite heavy, right?
They can get heavy. I mean, it depends on scale, but they can be heavy.
And some of your pieces found their way to Europe, or?
Yeah, true. I have a couple of pieces in Madrid, Spain.
That's fantastic.
And speaking of that, you've just been traveling international for a project, right?
It's true, yeah. Yeah, I did this really interesting project with, and I've never done anything like it. And I've learned a lot, but I was invited to respond to the salt ponds of Anguilla, which is a small island in the Eastern Caribbean. It's a British Virgin Island. And so I was sent 90 pounds of salt from this island and asked to make artwork with it. And then I recently flew out with the artwork and had an exhibition that's up right now, and did a series of events. So I did a workshop, and then I did a dinner with a local chef there, and with the salt from the island. And it was pretty amazing. I got to go and harvest some of the salt and really speak to a lot of the local communities about their relationship with salt and just the history of salt on the island. It's a over 400-year-old history. These were salt plantations that Africans were taken and labored on these bases. And since it's become a huge, it was a huge economy for the island for hundreds of years. And even in the 20th century, it was a place where it was pretty much the main economy of the island up until the 80s, when it kind of moved to tourism. And it was just a lot of people I spoke to had family members who had worked on at these salt ponds, or just had a lot of, just told me stories about how they would cook with this very specific salt, because it's very hard. They're hard, dense crystals. It's very different than the salt in the Bay Area. And instead of breaking up these big chunks of salt, they would know exactly what proportion they would need and how long to leave it in whatever they were cooking to salt their food. And it was just really, really a special way of engaging with a body of work and with a community.
Rachelle, I was not able to see your piece in the Modern Desert Markings. Would you like to tell our viewers, for those who were like me, not able to see it, what you did and how you did it?
Oh, yeah, totally. That's a great question. We've mostly talked about salt, which is one of my main projects, but another ongoing series I have been doing since about 2016 is going to different sites in the American West that are remote and have long legacies of industry or human impact in some way, also tracking them simultaneously with satellite imagery, and then private source travel satellite imagery. And then from that satellite imagery, I'm a research ambassador with a satellite company, so I'm able to access these images, and then I draw them photorealistically to kind of create more of a open, accessible image for everyone to see. And it's a conversation about what's private and what's public, especially in our visual culture and our relationship to landscape and private and public lands. A lot of this is done on public lands. For Modern Desert Markings, I visited the site of Jean Dry Lake, which was where Jean Tagley and Michael Heiser both had a piece in the 70s, actually Tingley, I think, was the 60s, and responding to that site, responding to what land art is and could be at the contemporary moment. When I went on the site visit with Brea and Steve, I had a satellite. When I got home, I downloaded the satellite images from that day, and I composited some images together, and then I drew them photorealistically. And then a part of my practice is also kind of comparing image to material. And so I did, with Rayette's help, I was able to collect some specimens and make sure I wasn't disrupting any environment or habitat with her approval. And then I made a piece with that too. So it's an opportunity to think through. There are two pieces, and one was mostly from the dirt of the place of Jean Dry Lake. And the other one was a highly rendered photorealistic drawing of an aerial image of the lake, the dry lake. And its intention was to think through a landscape and a place in both material and image, and the different ways in which we experience them. And then also just reflecting back in terms of land art, how the most of the public has been able to experience land art, which has been through images and documentation of some sort. It hasn't actually been going to the site. So it's a conversation about that too, and how we experience place now.
Right, because most of the land art is not visible now.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, that was interesting. Thank you for explaining that.
So you want to talk about the Silver Peak project?
Sure. So, like, the Silver Peak is also very, very similar in the sense that it was, the Silver Peak is this a place in Nevada where it has been a mining site for hundreds of years, and it has kind of it's gone from, I believe, silver to iron to ghost town, and in between ghost towns, and it's had this like boom and bust of resource and then nothing. And so it's a really interesting story of just how we treat landscape and mineral extraction, and kind of these cycle, it goes through these cycles with it. Its contemporary moment of whatever is of interest at the time. And at this point, it's the only active lithium site of lithium extraction in the country. There are, and I'll have to, I haven't actually triple checked that at this point, because I know that there have been many that are in process of being developed.
Mining for lithium seems to be a hot topic these days. Rachelle is correct. Albemarle operates the only active lithium mine in the United States at Silver Peak, Nevada. At that mine, lithium is extracted from brine, a liquid found beneath the ground.
At the time it was, and so I did a couple site visits. I dug clay at the site and made some ceramic pieces. I did a whole series of drawings and open access photographic work based on satellite images. I'm also working on an artist book. It's been an ongoing project just because it has a lot of richness, not only in its, and I think it has a, its story is an, is one that is almost like it's a story that I think is repeated a lot in terms of how we cycle through our landscapes. And it's a kind of a way of thinking about how we can perhaps move through thinking and using our mineral extraction differently.
I think I got a quote from you about getting back on Mother Nature's good side. And I was wondering how you're going to do that and how you suggest everyone else doesn't.
Yeah, that's not my quote. That was actually some like a write-up of a show I had in 2017, and now I'm trying to remember.
Oh my God, that 2017, that was 100. Yeah. That was a pandemic ago.
I know. I think what that writer was trying to, how we can think through the materials that come from the earth a little differently or mindfully. But that show was very much a material investigation. I think it's so easy to forget that, you know, the what we're using to power our conversation even is all from the earth, you know, and it's metals and that create these technologies. And, you know, even the salt on your table, it's just so easy to take for granted what is just right in front of us.
Do you want to talk about, there's another thing I read about, the space program. And when I read the space program, I was like, oh, okay, Rachelle's going to be blasted into outer space. But no, the space program is about space for a residency. It looks like, to me, it looks like quite the creativity heaven.
Yeah, so I'm supposed to do that residency in the fall, and I'm very excited. They have a lot of different options. They have metalworking and a lot of sculptural options, and then they have silk screening as well, and screen printing, I mean to say. Yeah, it's residencies are interesting because you don't really know what you're going to get until you're there, and they kind of take on a life of their own. So I can't speak too much about it, but it's a program that's been going on for a couple of years now, and it seems to be a really cool one because it does offer a lot of resources to artists and stipends and a lot of support. And this is the Bay Area is a tough place to exist as an artist. So it's nice that there are options like that that support artists further and help them build their career more.
I noticed you have a piece in the Women of Northern California.
Yeah, I had that show actually came down very recently, but it was about 30 artists from the 20th century into the present of females who are female identifying artists who have made their work and their life in here in Northern California. And I was honored to be included in that exhibition. There's a lot of artists there who I admired. My mentor, Hong Lu, was also in the show, which is always amazing to be with someone you so deeply respect and who's given so much to you. Let's see, I always forget what I have going on, which is silly, but I'm in an upcoming group show at the Marin Museum of Contemporary Art in June, over the summer, through the summer and through August, I believe. And that's with, I think, 11 artists. All of them are Bay Area artists bonding to different aspects of landscape. The show's on land. It's called On Land. And so I'm really looking forward to that as well. And then I have a couple things that are in the works that I am not yet talking about, but I'll let you know. Some commissions and various things that are keeping me pretty busy.
It sounds very interesting and something that would keep you very busy. When did you decide that you were an artist? How old were you?
I decided that, I've heard this a lot, but I do think that art kind of just chooses you. I have a distinct memory of being I don't know if I was in preschool or kindergarten, but I think I was around 5, and it was the first time I painted. Like a little easel was set up, and I dipped my brush into some red paint and then just put the paint on the paper. And that first brush stroke, I was like, I don't know what this is, but I need to do this for the rest of my life.
Oh,
wow.
Really?
That's great. Amazing.
Yeah. And so I just kind of followed that. Sometimes I feel like it's a little bit of a curse because being an artist is super strange. There's no path and nothing makes sense. It definitely puts you outside of different, more normal ways of living. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely led me to some interesting things, and I feel very lucky to have this gift, basically. I think of it as a gift, and in the sense that I will never be bored, and I will always feel inspired. And I sometimes forget that not everyone has that, and I'm constantly, no matter how hard being an artist can be because of its unsteadiness and because of its rejection, and there's so much difficulty and just even like logistics of healthcare and various taxes and just normal life things that you're kind of forced to do as an adult is a little harder as an artist, I find. Whenever that feels really difficult, I always try to remind myself that of what a gift this is.
Yeah, I would say, and I'll say thank you because you're also giving us a gift.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, it feels, and that's the other thing about being an artist is that you just do it because you feel like, or at least I did, because I just felt like I had to. I didn't really have a choice. It was just something I knew I needed to be doing with my life. The world doesn't like greet you and be like, yes, this is what you should do. Here's everything you need. You know, it's very much like, oh, we're going to reject you for 20 years and, you know, not give you any external validation for a long time. And you just have to like continue to believe that this is the what you need to be doing. So
along that line, can you tell us about your personal breakthrough art piece?
Let's see. I think breakthrough art piece. I've never even thought about that. I would say, I think maybe my first salt circle was pretty much a breakthrough. And it wasn't even a breakthrough because it took me 4 years to make. but once I was able to make it and make it as stable as I could, and it worked, it was a pretty big deal. I think learning to trust myself in something so strange too. Like I was making this work in grad school and I was told that it was a waste of time because it wasn't archival and you would never be successful with the market and who's going to want anything made of salt and this and that. I just didn't listen because I was so interested in the material, and it's been really amazing to see how many doors have opened because of this body of work and how important it is just to not listen sometimes to other people and if you believe in something. Yeah, and I think that's taught me quite a bit of just kind of getting outside the box and creating your own definition about what art is and what it...
So you just talked about your breakthrough piece. Let me ask you about your commercial breakthrough art piece. Or is that it?
I mean, that's the thing. It's the crazy thing about it is that it wasn't overnight. I kept making the work because I was sincerely interested in it. And then, you know, after about 4 years of making it, it started getting some traction. But, you know, there were four quiet years, you know. So I think that just so much of it is just hanging on.
It sounds like you believe there are no rules for art, or if there are, you're going to break those.
I think it might be a little more fun and interesting to break it, yeah.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah, I think the Silver Peak series, actually, to be honest, that was fairly recent. Maybe I made that in 2021, or I'd started the Silver Peak series in 2018, but the work that I kind of, when I really pushed it to a bigger scale using archival pigment prints on aluminum, I was able to think of that series in a different way and I think push that a little more and just be okay with working on these projects for years, you know, and realizing you don't have to churn it out every year. I get a new project or a new body of work, or I can continue a body of work rather than create something entirely new.
Rachelle, you make a living out of art. And not too many people make a living out of art. One of the questions we had, basic questions, was do you make art to sell or for your soul? Obviously, to feed your soul, you have to sell. But is there a balance in there? Do you ever do a piece of art that you don't particularly like, but you know it's going to sell?
No, I think it's really important to be transparent as possible about these kinds of things because it is. Like, that's the strange thing about being an artist is that there's this opacity. Like, you never ever, especially with like social media culture where everyone just looks great, you never really know, you know, what's happening or how difficult or, you know, if someone's struggling. But I think that I work on a lot of commissions and I'm lucky in that I enjoy doing commissions and it's very close enough to the work I already make, and that's kind of what gets me through a lot. That's not something I would ever have expected either, but I do think there is a lot, I know there is a lot of stress financially when you depend fully on your artwork and you do have to do things that you don't really like. I do other things just to make art full-time because I am very uncomfortable with some of the things I would have to do. I don't want to bend my work very much, especially my more research-based work. My work with satellites, you know, drawings don't have a high price point. I teach, I curate, I do a lot of other things that are engaged with art. I think that's also kind of what feeds my art. too, is a resistance to my time. It's always like a check and seeing how much I really want to be making it. It's great to know that for the last few years I have been able to live solely off my work, but it's also, it's a difficult thing if you're trying to plan for a long-term situation, or, you know, in terms of like, if you ever want a savings account or retirement, or if you have a child or you want a family. I mean, those things are difficult to have inconsistent monthly or annual income. It's kind of a give and take. And the way I think about it in terms of, and the way things have gone for me, is that I've had chapters where I've worked full time as an artist, and that's been great. But I've also worked for a couple years at a time with jobs, and that's been great in a different way. And so I have a very long view of my art practice. It's not going to go away. It's been with me as long as I can really remember. And so I try not to take that kind of, I just try to be as sincere to the work as I can be, I guess that's what I'm trying to say.
Thank you. Turning towards the future, what excites you about your art, Rachelle?
These are great questions.
We researched you deeply. You know, we used our, we used our research assistant. Ha ha.
Pushing your limit and seeing the different places where your art can go. I mean, just this project I did in the Caribbean, I would have never guessed for that to happen. The kind of conversations I was able to have, would have never imagined. So I think just like, it's amazing when you just make the work and put it out in the world, how, you know, if the world responds.
And I think what you're saying is you're evolving. You're constantly evolving.
I hope so.
Rachelle, do you dream about your art?
I do. I'm never really making it, but I'm always like, I dream. No, that's not true. Sometimes I see art. Yeah, I dream about it. Not art that I'm making at the moment, usually, but like I'll be in a studio or I'll see artwork or I'll be in an exhibition of mine. But I don't dream up artwork. I kind of wish I did. I've been trying to do that. It seems
really
be a little more efficient with studio time, but it doesn't work for me.
Yeah, it's interesting how that question's answered, because some people dream about it. Some people have nightmares.
Uh-huh.
So, goodness, I wouldn't want that. Shell, if you could go back in time in the art world, where would you go and why?
That is a good question. I would go, I'm going like to 75 different places. I would really want to experience New York City from 60s through 70s. That's always something I've romanticized in my mind, that space that includes, you know, the land artists and that we just addressed in modern desert markings. And just having grown up outside of New York City and worked in New York City for 10 years, and I really have a love for that city and that the creativity that happened there. I was always kind of romanticizing it, even like the 1950s with the abstract expressionists. I just want to see that. I want to see if it's really all the hype. And then I would just love to see those cave paintings, you know, or like what the actual colors of the Egyptian temples were. I've always kind of fantasized about that as well.
Good. So, wow. You would be taking a lot of trips back in time.
She would.
If we can dream of that, we can.
When you start your art, especially if you're starting a new idea, do you work that out and all of it out in your mind before you start, or does your piece evolve as you work on it?
Whenever I start a new idea, I basically feel like I've forgotten everything. I have no idea how to make anything. Mm-hmm. And tends to be a lot of failure, to be honest. And I've gotten, and I'm overall just kind of terrified. And I've gotten a little more used to it now, and I try not to like have a crisis over that beginning stages when you don't quite know what you're making yet, but you know you're trying to get somewhere and you feel like you're not getting anywhere. I just know it's part of the process and it's part of this cycle. It's the part I dread, to be honest, and it's the hardest part for me. Kind of that like first trimester in pregnancy where you're kind of where the woman's like morning sick and doing all the hard work of building the spine and the brain and the eyeballs and toenails and things like that. Yeah, but then if I've made a piece similar to it, I also something that I've been really excited about that I've noticed that I've developed pretty strongly is my visual imagination. And I can kind of walk into a space and get a good visual on what a work would look like in that space, or even with for myself pieces now, I just draw everything out first before I make everything in terms and think about like color, shape, scale, like materials, if I'm going to be framing it in steel, and I'll just kind of get all that worked out first. And that's been really fun because I have enough visual memory of making that work that I can kind of build it in my mind now. If I'm working on a project like the Silver V project, I dug my own clay and I made some pieces there, and that was just felt like a million failures, but like the concept was there and it was important that I use that material. So I kept trying to like work through it, and I'm actually still working through better resolving those pieces. So I think it just depends on what I'm working on, I guess.
That's so encouraging for novice artists to hear, because we see you successful artists and all that you do, and we think it just probably flows from you, that you never have to do any problem solving. It just all comes out and it's perfect the first time. So we appreciate you sharing that with us.
Oh my gosh, yeah, of course. No, it's not. I'm not just like flowing with inspiration at all times. It feels very much like a excavation more than anything else.
Okay, so sometimes it feels like work.
Oh, it's definitely work.
Okay. And problem solving, which is what I always say art is problem solving.
Well, we have our math teacher here, Linda. So Linda's always into problem. Art is problem solving.
Right. I have used trigonometry in my work, you know.
Really?
Out things.
Sure, that's exciting.
I mean, if you're ever working at large scales with a lot of different forces, definitely geometry.
Okay, one dumb question while you're doing this.
No dumb questions? There are no dumb questions.
Oh, I thought you meant I couldn't ask this
question. No, of course you can ask the question. No.
So, this is a fluff question. While you're in your studio, but maybe you just blew it all up because you said you're out digging your own clay. So you're not just in your studio doing art. You're preparing. You're gathering your elements. But in any case, do you listen to music, radio, book on tape?
I do all of it. Yeah, I do all of it. I try to listen to music as much as I can. But if I'm drawing, I'll have a thing where I listen to music in the beginning because it's the hardest part, and I can't have any words because I have to think really hard. Usually in the beginning of making anything, I have to just have no words because I find that too distracting. But then once I find a flow of like a drawing, I think for the modern desert markings drawing, I listen to the whole book, full 21 hours of Ministry for the Future by Kim Stanley Robinson.
Wow.
And then I had to listen to a bunch of other things too, because it wasn't, I that drawing was more than 21 hours.
Wow.
Yeah. So when I'm sitting in one place working on one thing, like a long, highly rendered drawing, definitely audiobooks, but not in the beginning. But my salt pieces, I kind of do. I listen to, I do it all. I really like public radio. I like listen to Calix, which is the UC Berkeley radio, a lot. Yeah.
What message, if any, would you like people to see with your art?
I don't think it would be fair for me to just, I think, prescribe anything.
Mm-hmm.
I just hope it raises questions and it inspires them to find some curiosity about art making, but also about environment, especially if they're living in proximity or have visited the places that I'm addressing in my work.
So rather than having a message, you'd rather start a conversation.
Exactly. Yeah. It's a nice way of putting it.
Ooh, I like that. Rachelle, what has inspired you this past week?
We've had really beautiful weather in the Bay Area this week, and we haven't had that in this past season. So just, I think, being outside, I've been tending to my garden, or last weekend I spent a lot of time tending to my garden. I have a 3-year-old, and she helped me a lot, and kind of being outside, being like, and playing with her. And we planted a bunch of some lettuces and some asparagus together, just having kind of facilitating a relationship to the earth through my daughter. Is really important and inspiring. I mean, it's the only what inspired it. I'm not a gardener. I didn't grow. I'm very new at this. So it was definitely a pandemic project that I've just continued because it's awesome. One of the things that continues to inspire it is it's the only way I can get my kids to eat anything green.
Oh.
Yeah. But that's kind of cool. I mean, I definitely didn't have an experience where I was able to pick something off a vine or, you know, and just eat it. It's cool that I can give that to her.
Absolutely. You know, along those lines, when I interviewed Alicia, which I think Alicia Curlin was a really good interview. She has a garden in her front yard. And so besides doing the gardening with her daughter, she says how being in the front yard, she gets to meet her neighbors.
Yeah. Oh, sure.
Yeah. And that's, I told her I want to go come see your garden sometime in your front yard. I really like the idea of that.
Yeah. I mean, what's really fun is that we've been really successful in growing, like, greens like kale and chard, and I live in a place where my neighbors are very, very close to them, but we're all friends, so we always invite our neighbors to come. We give them food all the time, and my neighbor gives me lemons from her lemon tree, and it's this nice kind of exchange where we never have to buy greens, or, you know, we just kind of live off of our block a little bit.
That is nice. Yeah. And that sounds very inspiring to share your love of the land, of the earth, with your daughter.
Yeah, I grew up in a place with, like, a lot of concrete, mm-hmm. not many, you know, and just there wasn't really I didn't have any help with kind of facilitating any kind of connection, or there was not any conversation around that. And I think we have that from the very beginning, like, that relationship. You can see it in kids just loving to be outside and wanting to climb trees and loving dirt. And so just figuring out how to encourage that and foster a positive relationship with that.
Sure. Well, Rachelle, we thank you so much for taking time to talk with us today. We love your art, and your art is very inspiring.
Thank you. And thank you for producing these podcasts. I've listened to some, and it's been really cool to hear more about artist practices and just your questions, and I really appreciate you asking me to be on this, so thank you.
Thank you very much.
Broadcasting from Mesquite, Nevada, in the scenic Mojave Desert, the Art Box sponsors thank you for listening. To find our next and past podcasts, find us online at mesquitefineartcenter.com, where all accompanying images and links are available on the Art Box page. Questions, comments, opinions, and concerns can be sent to artboxvv@gmail.com. The views and opinions expressed in this podcast are solely those of its hosts and guests and do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of the Virgin Valley Artists Association.